एंड द कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ ईडीए दैट इज एक्सप्लोरेटरी डेटा एनालिसिस एंड सम पार्ट ऑफ डेटा प्री प्रोसेसिंग. So, like if we just go through the contents that we will discuss, we will just have an introduction that what is EDA, what are the benefits. Then we will discuss the various, you can say the techniques by which EDA can be performed. Then we will see the various steps involved in the whole analysis process. And then after we will also discuss about the various kind of variables of our interest and how they are distributed and how the same thing can be useful to understand the more internal details of all those variables. Then we will do little bit of data pre-processing where we will try to manage the missing values or what are the various ways by which the missing values can be treated. Similarly, for pre-processing, many of the times we need to convert our categorical data into the numerical. So how those kind of transformations can be done. And so we'll also discuss about the normalization or the normalizing or scaling of your values or the data. And then after we will see various techniques for univariate and bivariate analysis. So this will be the overall flow. And throughout this flow, we will try to understand a case study that is using the, you can say, Jupyter Notebook and Python, and where we will take the data set of a Titanic. So you know the, we all know the little bit history of that incident and the ship and all these things. So we will just try to use the same data set to apply various EDA steps and the pre-processing that we may need to apply on it. So let us start with the introduction part. So EDA or exploratory data analysis is an approach, or you can say a philosophy, which is made up of several techniques. And
sir, little louder, it is not audible, that it is very feeble voices.
Yes, is it so or it is audible? Huh?
No, sir, you are clearly audible. I think there is a problem at her
end. It is clear.
Okay, because I think all participants or others are not having problems. So, ma'am, please check your headphone or maybe some other issue. Right? So, ADA basically is an approach, or you can say analyzing the data or the data set that you want to apply. See, because you have already studied some techniques, like Kadal madam also explained about the your some techniques like regression and all those things on the various data sets. Similarly, Goel also today morning explained about some of the techniques of machine learning. So before you go for applying of all such techniques, it is better to understand the little bit about data so that we can better apply the particular model or particular technique. So the EDA is whole focused on that, and where we will try to maximize our insight about the data. So we want to get maximum details from the data, either visually or you can say with a non-GUI way, with the some numbers. We try to uncover the basic structure, means we try to, you can say, what are the number of variables that we have, what are the number of features that we have, what kind of values do they hold, then what is the distribution of those variables. So all such things are identified, even the relationships, like how those variables are or the features are related with each other. So that will help us to consider the important variables and all such things. So that is also the part, or you can say the one of way by which EDA is useful. It can help us to detect the anomalies and the outliers. So we can, before applying any of your machine learning algorithm, it is better that we treat all our data so that there are no null values, or there are some outliers are there, so which may affect the overall result. So how those outliers can be treated, so identification of outliers and all such things, you can do better using the EDA. And even hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So along with that, we can also perform some tests to identify the, you can say, our assumptions. We can let's say whenever we see a data, let's say in our case we are going to refer the Titanic data set, which is in a CSV format. It is a very small data set, but if we open it in Excel, then we cannot get such internal information. Like just by reading the rows and the columns, we cannot interpret all such things. So if we have some assumptions, like in the Titanic event, let's say if we have an assumption like the number of survived people are more female than the male. So that may be our assumption. So you can use the EDA technique so that you can validate your assumption, that whether whatever assumption you have made is valid or not. You can graphically display such things. You can find out the correlation. You can display it in terms of numbers and all such things. Right? So it is very useful approach before you actually apply the your any of the machine learning algorithm. And even you train the algorithm, you should always do the pre-processing and exploratory analysis. So if we try to broadly classify the various techniques for EDA, those can be classified by either they are graphical or non-graphical, or on the basis of univariate or multivariate. So non-graphical methods are the methods in which we find out some statistics about the variables. Fine, where we will get the summary, like it can be in terms of a mean or a variance, or you can say the correlation or the covariance, or it may be in terms of some tabulation of data, important summary of the data. So that way we try to analyze, or it can be in terms of a pictorial way. So either we do some, let's say histogram, or we do some bar plot, or we do some box plot, maybe pie chart or scatter plot. So there are so many different ways we can analyze or we can view the internals of the data. So it can be either graphical or non-graphical. And similarly, the second way we can consider the EDA technique is either univariate or multivariate. So univariate in the sense, like out of our data set, let's say we have 100 columns or 50 columns, we try to analyze one of the column. So that is our univariate analysis. Like we don't want to analyze all the columns or something, but let's say one by one, or else it can be bivariate or multivariate. So in that case, we try to analyze the relationship between the two or more columns or the variables. Fine. So in that case also, your columns or variables may be of different type, and based on that, you have to apply some different technique. So after all, what we can say is whenever you go for any kind of EDA, it can be graphical univariate, or it can be graphical multivariate, or else it can be non-graphical univariate and non-graphical multivariate. So this is what we can say about the overall broad way of classifying EDA techniques. Now, if we just go through the various steps which are involved throughout the this exploration process, and those are, first of all, we have to acquire the data set, that whichever data set we want to understand. Then we just should get the overview of our data set, in the sense like what is the size in terms of number of rows and columns, then what are the columns available, what are the data types of those columns. So all such basic information we should get. That's the first step. Then we will try to identify the various types of variables in terms of let's say, what is the data type? What is there any null value present or not? Whether it is the numeric variable or it's a categorical variable. So that way we have to identify the various variables. Then after
sir, somebody mic is on. We are not able to hear properly. There is some background noise coming on.
Yes. So maybe the person who is handling the meeting can mute rest
sir,
of the
participants. Muted all the attendees.
Okay. So once we have identified the variables, then we can go through those variables and we can find out the missing values. Or there may be some features or the variables for which we do not have the some of the values are missing. So how to handle them? Those that's a missing value treatment. Then after we may have the outlier treatment. That is we may have a particular variable which is having some value which is beyond the expected range. Let us say if we consider an age of a person, then it may be between 1 and 100. But if it is something like 113 or maybe like minus something, then those are the outliers. So those must also be treated by various ways. Then variable transformation, where you do the appropriate scaling or the normalization of the variables. And once all such operations are over, those you can say are kind of pre-processing. And then your actual analysis starts, where you do either univariate, bivariate, and again, as I said, it can be graphical or non-graphical. So these are the steps that we have to perform for any analysis process. So let us first of all understand what do we mean by a variable and distribution of a data. So a variable, sometimes you may call it a feature. So it is any characteristic of an individual that is of interest to the researcher. Means whatever is the, you can say, entity about which we want to understand or we want to apply some machine learning technique, then the features or the characteristics of those individuals are called the variables. Basically, the broad way of classifying variable, it can be either, you can say, categorical or numerical. So categorical variables are several times also called qualitative. And again, those qualitative variables can be either nominal or ordinal. So in case of nominal variable, where the values are coming from, let's say, some range, you can consider a gender. So where in that case, the values are not numeric, it can be male, female, or such kind of values. And one thing about the nominal is, their order is not making any difference. Whereas the other category of categorical variable is ordinal variable, where the order of the values has some importance, like a degree. So like we can all understand that if he's having SSC or let's say a diploma or engineering or maybe postgraduate and doctorate. So we know that the values are coming from this group, but there is some meaning of the order. Either you and just by looking at those, we can interpret the importance. Fine. Same thing, it can be applied to your the passenger class. Let's say in our data set, we have a passenger class is one of the variable, which is a categorical variable, and where the class indicates that in the whole journey of the Titanic, a person traveled in which class, first class, second class, or third class of journey. So that makes, you can say, some difference. That's ordering. So the one way of, you can have a one kind of variables are the categorical variables, either it can be nominal or ordinal. The second category of variable can be a numeric, where the values are coming as generally the numbers. And again, the numeric variables can be discrete or continuous. So discrete means they generally take the whole numbers. Like you may have the number of persons working in your department or in the office. Then it can be 1, 2, 300 or whatever. But it cannot be like 3.5 or something generally. And similarly, the numerical variable, which is quantitative, it can be continuous also. Continuous in the nature means it can take any value. Any you can say the real value, maybe one in the fraction or the decimal places and all such things. So that is one way that you can classify variable, either it's a categorical or numerical. The other way you can consider variable is in terms of the target variable and or the exploratory variable. So whenever you consider any data, you may have some target variable.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. I think slides are not moving. It is in EDA process.
Yeah, now is it okay now?
No. Only in it is EDA process.
It is still on the process.
Same. Yeah.
No. Actually moving, we are on the variables and distribution of data on that slide.
Yeah, so like I'm discussing about the target and exploratory variable, and if I move to the next, it is graph. So can you see that movement?
EDA process.
No, we are not saying. I think we have to refresh it.
It is fixed on EDA process for me.
What about others? Like, should I?
For me also.
No,
for me
also. Actually, I am seeing variables and distribution of data.
Let me share it again.
Hello, is any activity going on? Is it being shared?
No, sir. Expert is sharing again. Okay, so please wait. dear participants, expert is facing network issue, so he will be right back, okay?
घनश्याम जी, हेलो।
यस सर, बोलिए।
हाँ, एक्चुअली यस्टरडे सेशन टूज वो मैडम गूगल कोलैब नोटबुक है वो थोड़ा शेयर नहीं
किया। इनर सेशन टू काजल मैडम का था वो या लास्ट सेशन था वो प्रैक्टिकल सेशन?
नहीं, सेशन टू, लास्ट वाज प्रैक्टिस सेशन, सेशन टू उनका जो कोलैब गूगल कोलैब नोटबुक था तो वो नोटबुक अगर शेयर करते तो यहाँ आसानी होता थोड़ा।
ओके ओके, नो इश्यू, मैं उनसे बात करके फिर कांटेक्ट करके आपको जो भी होगा वो बता दूंगी।
वो फाइल सेक्शन में ही सारा चीज रख दीजिए टीम्स का, तो बेटर रहेगा हमें डे वाइज डाउनलोड करने।
वैसे वो लास्ट मैंने फर्स्ट सेशन की अपलोड किया हुआ है मैंने पीपीटी फाइल सेक्शन में।
हाँ हाँ, वो एक्चुअली टू पीपीटीज आर देयर, वी गॉट इट, बट या दोस फाइल्स इफ यू गेट प्लीज।
ओके ओके
मैम, इज इट विजिबल नाउ द स्क्रीन?
यस सर।
ओके, आई एम चेंजिंग द स्लाइड्स, सो आई थिंक दैट इज आल्सो कमिंग ना?
यस सर, यस,
यस, इट्स कमिंग।
ओके ओके, सो वी वर जस्ट डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द वेज वी कैन क्लासिफाई द वेरिएबल्स। इट कैन बी आइदर कैटेगोरिकल न्यूमेरिकल और इट कैन बी बेस्ड ऑन the our interest. We can say the variable can be a target or output variable, means that is the output of your data, output column of your data set, or else the input variables or the exploratory variables by, or you can say those are the independent variables by using which you will try to predict your output variable. So they can be considered either in terms of a target or exploratory variable. If you if we talk about the distribution of a variable, we'll not go in much detail and mathematical formulas of all such, but visually if you just see, then the distribution of the variable tells us that what kind of values it takes and how often it takes. Fine, so it can be either in terms of a normal distribution, a bell curve, or it can be a skewed values like which you can see in the second and the third figure, or it can be a binomial distribution, it can be a reverse J distribution, or it can be a uniform distribution across all your samples. So basically the distribution of a variable will say that what kind of values it, the variable acquires and in which frequency. And we'll see some of the graphs later on also. And that it can also help you to understand the probability of the values the variable may have. Let's say if we consider the normal distribution, then you may have the curve like this bell kind of curve, and where if you consider zero as a mean, then the values which you get between the standard deviation plus and the minus, so it would be around 68%. Means if you say your variable is having a normal distribution, then what you can get from this is like 68% of the values for that variable will lie between the zero and plus or minus the first normal distribution. Similarly, if you consider the zero to two standard deviation plus and the two standard deviation minus, then it will occupy around, let's say, 95% of your data. So that will tell you that how much probable or which probable value the data will take. So just knowing this kind of, you can say the distribution can help you to better understand that what kind of values or majority of the time, which values will be taken by the variable. So this may vary distribution to distribution, but just for getting the brief idea that how the distribution can help, I have kept this diagram over here. So now let us continue with our actual data set, or if we go side by side, then it will be easy for you to get the view, and we can do the things practically also. So what we will do now onwards is we will try to run the code as well as we will try to see the presentation side by side. So as I said earlier also, that we will be using the Titanic dataset. It is a dataset having 12 columns, and it has around 900 rows. So let us try to first of all import the necessary libraries. So we'll be using Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib, and the Seaborn. So these are the libraries that you may require. I will share the CSV file as well as the code immediately after the presentation of this session, so that you can work with this, or you can play with this during your lab sessions. So the next step is to, you can say, the load the data set, so that we are just reading the values of our data into a variable that is a train. So now if we just want to just go through this data set, then it has the columns like a passenger ID, survived, then the passenger class, the name of the person, the gender, age, whether it is traveling with the, you can say, the siblings or the spouse, the number of, you can say, the parents or the children on board, the ticket is the ticket number of that particular person, the fare is the amount that he or she has paid, embarked is the field which holds the some one letter value like a C or the Q or the S, indicates the that from where the from which port the passenger has embarked. And in this whole data set, let's say there are 12 columns, out of which the survived is a target variable. So survived is a target variable in the sense we want to do some kind of prediction, or we want to analyze all our data based on this survived variable. So whether the person survived or not, having zero or one value. And so in our data set, there is one column survived that will be our target, or you can say the output variable, along with which we will do all such comparisons and analysis. So if we talk about the categorical variables, then in our data set, many of the variables or the columns are categorical. Like the survived, it has only two values, gender or the sex. Then the class of the passenger, which is, as I said, a kind of categorical variable, but it is ordinal because the order has some difference. Similarly, the embark, cabin, name, ticket, and sibling, the parent, child, those all are the categorical variables. Along with this, we have just three variables which are numerical, and those are the fare, age, and the passenger ID. So once we have loaded the data set, you can use the head method, which will just give you the top rows from your data set, and you can see that all the 12 columns and the values. So whenever you load any data set, then the first thing is you understand the columns, you list out some of the top rows. Similarly, the tail method with the frame, you can find out the last five rows from your data set. So you can use the head and tail method. So see, whenever you do exploration analysis of any data set, ideally these are the ways you should follow. You load the data set, you try to just load the head or the tail values, so that you can have some meaning out of this. Fine. Along with the each of the data set, you have the description available, what kind of variables it is holding. So that is also quite useful, like as we discussed earlier. Then you can call a shape method. The shape will tell you that what is the shape of your data set. So in our case, in 891 by 12, then it says that there are total 891 rows in our data set, and out of which there are total 12 columns.
Since we lost his voice.
हेलो
हेलो
एम आई ऑडिबल हां बोलो
यस सर
સંભળાય છે ને વચ્ચે ડિસ્કનેક્ટ ખબર નહીં કેમ થઈ જાય છે ઇઝ ઇટ ઓકે ને
વચ્ચે ડિસ્કનેક્ટ થઈ જાય છે હા સર ઇઝ ઇટ ઇઝ
ઓકે સો ધ સેમ્પલ ઇઝ અ મેથડ બાય વિચ ઇન વિચ યુ કેન પાસ સમ નંબર એન્ડ ઇટ વિલ ફેચ આઉટ ધોઝ નંબર ઓફ રેન્ડમ રોઝ ઇનટુ ધ મેમરી એન્ડ ધોઝ કેન બી ડિસ્પ્લેડ સો જસ્ટ રેન્ડમલી ઇફ યુ વોન્ટ ટુ સી એની રોઝ યુ કેન યુઝ ધ સેમ્પલ મેથડ ધેન There is one more property that you can call is D types. So D types will tell you the data type of all your variables. So that is what that we understood in the steps also. First we have to load data set, then we have to get the brief information about our data set. So these all are the brief details, very very high level details like number of rows, columns, the getting to some top rows. Or getting some samples out of it, or else even you can say the getting the data type. Even you can use the columns property, which will just give you the list of columns available in your data set. So in our case, there are total 12 columns, and the data type is it is showing object because you can see now. Yes, if you just see the DB types, you can observe that passenger ID is integer, survived is integer. As such, it is a categorical variable. It is taking value 1 and 0 whether a person has survived or not. You can observe that also from your the samples like 0 1 0 1 it is getting. The class is coming from 1 2 3. So all such things, even the data types, because whenever you want to apply any algorithm or technique, if the values are in terms of, let's say, the textual data, then you may not be able to directly apply all your techniques. So you may need to do some conversion or the transformation in those cases. So knowing the data types is also important part whenever you work with any of your data sets. So in our case, some variables are object. So let's say name is showing as object because it's a string. Similarly, the sex or the gender is either a male, M-A-L-E, or female. So it is showing as an object. Similarly, ticket is a number. So it is showing as an object. And so you can use this DB types method. You can use the columns property to get the list of the columns. And even if you want to get more information, then you can just do the dot info method, and that will give you some extra information regarding each and every column. And what I say, one extra information which you are getting is how many values are not null. So just by getting the info, for this passenger ID, you have 891 values available. Means there is no missing in it. Similarly, but if you see the age variable, then we can see that there are only 714 records in which we have the age value available. The remaining columns or the rows do not have. So that is our missing value. So in that case, there should be some way so that we can manage those missing values. And once the missing values are managed, then only you can do some, you can say, further analysis or bivariate or univariate. So we have to impute the missing value. Similarly, for the cabin also, you can see there are so many missing values. Only 204 values are available. So just by getting the info, you will get such information about the your data set. Then you can call about the columns, and in our case we have just done train.describe include integer and float. It means we want to describe only the integer and float columns. So there are around, you can say, 3 and 4, 7 columns which are of type either integer or float. Rest 5 are of type object. Maybe they are storing the textual information. So by just doing this describe method, you can get the count. Count says how many values are available. Here also you can understand that these values are missing. It gives you the mean value. Mean in the sense, I think you know the basic concepts of the mean, median, mode, and all such things. Fine. So mean, you can say, is a kind of an average, so that average of your variable. So if we just try to understand this, then what we can get from this is, like, let's say for the age variable, the mean is 29.6. So what does it say? That whatever 714 ages that we do have in our data set, out of those, the average age of a person is 29.6. So those who traveled in the Titanic the people were, you can say from this, they were quite young. Many of them were, or you can say the average age was around 29. But along with that, you can get the some values like minimum and maximum. So that also is some kind of indication. Like the minimum age of the person who traveled, who was on board, was 0.42. Let's say if we consider it in terms of the years. And the maximum age was 80. So it may be someone who is newborn, or let's say maybe below 1 year of age, and there may be one elderly person who is 80 years of age. So just by getting this kind of description, you can get so many things. This values like the standard deviation, the minimum value, the 75%, 25%, and the 50%, those are your, you can say, the interquartile range. So within this range, how many people fall, and all such things. Fine. So we'll see this IQ range with example later on. But just by looking at the, and again, this kind of values, or you can say the describe, may not be useful for all such columns. Fine. Let's say the passenger ID. It is some numeric ID given to a passenger. It is not at all affecting your, you can say the output variable. Our output variable is survived, whether the passenger survived or not. So it has very less, you can say, relation. Fine. So, and for such kind of variables, you cannot get, or interpreting those values may not make much sense. Fine. So let us continue. So you can have a describe. Similarly, you can have the describe method applied on the object. So let me run this part. So what it says, there are total 891 names, and because name is a variable which is having some text, and what it says is all 891 unique. It means there were no two passengers having same name. So for object kind of, so it is better that you, whenever you try to describe your variables, you do, if you just do describe all, then you will not get all the details. So better you describe first your numeric variables, then you go for the object variable. So let's say for the sex category or the sex variable, you have a total for all the passengers, you have that information available. And there are maximum two unique values, means the male or the female. Similarly for the ticket, cabin, and embarked. And one more thing to observe from this is top. So this is again quite important to understand whenever you do describe. So the top description says that whatever number of possible unique values you have, out of those, which category has maximum values and how many. So let's say if we consider the sex column or the gender column, we have 891 different gender values available. The variations are two, because maybe you're female, male or female. But we can see that the male is having the highest frequency. It in the sense that, and how, what is the frequency? 577. Then we can easily interpret from this is like the person who traveled on that ship, out of which, compared to female, more male traveled in that ship. And the frequency, you can obviously get 577 male. So if you minus it from 891, then you can say those will be the female. Similarly for the embark field, if we see, then we have three unique variables available, or values available, means the port from where the passenger has onboarded. Fine. So out of which the S has maximum value, maximum occurrences. So what does it mean? That maximum of the people out of 891 boarded from the S. So just by knowing that which value has highest frequency, the topmost frequency, and what is the frequency, that can also give you some information. So after all, the overall purpose of your EDI is to maximize our knowledge about the data. just by utilizing simple commands or by visualizing some graphs. So let us continue. Now let us try to handle the missing, because see, as per the flow that we are following is like the next thing is data pre-processing. Like we understood the variables and the distribution, then we were at the pre-processing task, and the first thing that we have to do is we have to process the null values. So in our example, the Titanium dataset, the age column has so many you can say null values. Now how can we handle those null values? There can be several approaches. One of the approaches is delete null records. It means out of 891 records, wherever the age is missing, you delete those records, and then you apply all your further analysis and processing. And so, but it is not advisable in many of the cases, because it may reduce the size of your data set. And even if we delete the particular record, yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because I just got a beep that disconnected. Okay, anyway. So what we can do is we can delete the records, but in that case, based on particular variable, if we delete a record and if that variable is of not of that much importance to our output variable, then we may unnecessarily lose the data. So deletion of the records is not much advisable for the data set which are very small in size. The alternate for handling the missing values is you impute the mean, median, or the mode values. It means the age is the variable in our case, for which we have around 20% or the 200 rows are missing, then what we can do is for all those missing rows, we can keep the mean age of passenger, that is 29 something at this time, to all the places. Or you can specify the median or the mode value. Mode in the sense, the one which is having highest frequency, you in place them. So that is the alternate way we can do. The alternate way you can do for processing null values is you can impute by utilizing some more complex machine learning based techniques, or maybe some analysis of your data. So you can have your own model which will try to find out the relationship between the missing values and the available values, and will try to predict that what is the best possible value for the missing variable. So that kind of techniques can also be applied. So in our case, in our data set of our Titanium data set, let us see how can we manage those missing values. Okay, so let us see. So first of all, you can call the isNull method. isNull method will just give you that, it will just try to list out all the 890 rows, some top and some bottom, and then just by it will print true and false. And in the age column, if you see, then you may find out there is a true. It means that it has some values which are null. So you can use a isNull method just to get the brief of your that whether that column is getting null values or not. So our interest column at this point of time is the age column. Fine. So now we want to fill up the values of the age. So but we will not delete, we will not keep the mean. Let us see what how better we can manage those values. The alternate way of finding out, or you can say displaying the null values, is you can also show in terms of the heat plot, or sorry, the heat map. So the heat map shows, you can see that for all your columns, it tries to plot the bars, and in whichever column you have the missing values, it will change the color. So just by looking at this, so what you can do is you can do the your heat map function, where you pass the values that for which data you want to print the heat map, then you can graphically see now that your age column and the cabin column has very missing values. Fine. So now let us try to focus on the age only, because that we want to consider, or that we say that we think that it has more relation with the our output variable, that is survived or not. So let us try to further analyze by plotting some graph. So we are just printing a count plot. And in the count plot, what do we do? On the x-axis, we are plotting the survived. And our hue means the second column that we want to compare it with the sex or the gender. So what this graph will indicate, let's say on the x-axis, we have two values, that's a survived, whether zero means the person died, did not survive, and one means the person tried to or survived from that incident, because we know that the whole ship broke down, and we all might have seen that movie of Titanic, so we know the things. Okay? So now from this kind of graph, what we can interpret is, you can see that the one means the survived, and the sky block says the male, that number of males survived and the number of females survived. So just by looking at this, we can interpret that in this incident, one thing that we can observe is the number of person who died, who could not survive, are more. You make a sum of this plus this, that number is larger than the person who survived. But those who survived, we can observe that the pink one, that is the female, you can say, the passengers survived more compared to, you can say, the male. Right? So this kind of, you can say, insights of your data, you can get from just by plotting simple count plots. So let us go ahead, and we want some better way to impute the value of the ages. Fine. So even you can use the count plot to show the relationship between the passenger class and the passenger survived or not. So here on the x we are keeping the passenger class, and the you can say, and x is the survived, sorry, and u is the passenger class. So for each of the passenger class, it will show you how many person survived. So in our case, we know that in our data set, there are three different classes, first, second, and third. Then survived zero, survived one. So still, just by looking at this kind of count plot, we can understand that the number of people who survived are more in the first class. Means they may have got some VIP treatment during the incident. They may have access to the extra boats and whatever we can think of, and that is where we can observe. So this is what the EDA means, that you have to try to analyze and try to so that your assumptions may be proven, and you can have the better understanding of the data. Right. So here also the same thing is observable, that the dark blue color, which says that survived by the passenger class 1. Similarly, one thing that we can observe is for class 2, we can see that compared to the class 2, the class 3 passengers survived more. The one way it looks like this, but if you just try to compare the whole diagram or the graph, what you can observe is number of people who could not survive in the third class are more, quite more than the people who could not survive in class 1 and 2. So even though we see that number of people survived in class 3 more compared to class 2, but if you just think in terms of how many people traveled in the second class and how many people traveled in the third class, and if you get the percentage, then obviously you will find that graphically, it looks that there are less number of people who survived. But if you compare in terms of the traveled and survived, then obviously the second class, the passengers who traveled in second class survived more in terms of percentage compared to the third class. Right? So that is the one more thing that you can get by just using the count plot. Then we will see this box plot and again later also, but at this point of time, as we are doing some pre-processing, let's try to see the box plot. So the box plots are quite useful to get the details about the, you can say, the mean value and the outliers and the IQ range, the quartile range, like Q1, Q2, Q3. So we'll see that quartile range later on. But just by plotting this kind of the box plot, what we can get is we are plotting the box plot. On the x-axis, we take the class, that in the class in which the person has traveled, and what is the age? The age is on the y-axis. So the box plot says that the person who traveled in the first class, the average age of the person was around, let's say, 38 or 39 years. That is your mean value. Then you can have the Q3 and Q1, the minimum and the maximum. Similarly, for the class 2, the average age was around, let's say, 28 or 29. Average age of a person who traveled in the class 2 category. Similarly, the class 3, the average age is around, let's say, 25 years or so. So from this box plot, what we can see is in the third class or in the class 3 category, the people who traveled were more young compared to the first and the second class. One more thing, the dots which are visible in the box plot can be considered as some outliers, like some extreme values we have seen that you can observe here also in the second class. Like we saw that the age minimum value is 0.42 and maximum is 80 years. So those are not within the your IQ range. Fine. So those can be considered as outlier. But at this point of time, what we can get from this is we can get the average age of a person depending on the class in which he or she has traveled. So what smarter way you can do is, like we created one function to impute the ages, and our function checks that if the age value is null, then we check. If the passenger class is 1, then keep the value 37. How? Because we know that in the first class, the average age of a person is 37 years. So what we have done is, instead of taking the average or the mean of all the samples which are available and keeping the same value to all, we can have some more proper way of imputing the missing ages. So what we try to do is, we will try to impute the missing age depending on the person who traveled in which class. If person has traveled in second class, then what is the second class average age? Keep it that age for the null values, and same for all the classes. So that is a small, there is a small function. So this is just a small, you can say, thing that you can do for all your data sets. Like, instead of keeping the directly the mean or deleting records, you can have more internal details, and you can better keep the missing values. So what we will do is, we'll keep them 37, 29, and 24 for the missing ages, respectively, for the class of a person in which he has traveled. So let us run this. Then we are just calling the function. Then after that, let us do the heat map again. And now you can see, you can compare this heat map. Earlier, it was showing several yellow strips. Yeah, and which were the indication of the missing values. Now we have solved that issue. We have imputed the ages for all the missing things based on the class average. And so this is just the beginning, or you can say an example which you can carry on further for your data set, for your research. So that is one of the way you can impute the values for the null variables. Similarly, the next step of your, you can do the similar process for all the columns, fine, or some slight different process for different columns. But let us continue with now the further part of your pre-processing, where we have to you can say impute, or you can say instead of the categorical variable, you have to give some encoded values in terms of numbers. Fine. So let's say in our case, the embark, the gender, or the sex, sorry, those are the fields which are having the textual value. So in that case, we may need to convert them into the number so that they can be easily processed. So there can be several ways. Some of them I have listed. One of the ways is label encoding. So in case of label encoding, what is done? Let's say if you consider the column name is fruits, or the variable is fruits, and you have four fruits available: apple, banana, grapes, and the mango, let us say. So in that case, in the label case or label encoding case, let's say apple is given number one. So wherever there is an apple in the data, it will keep the number one. Then banana is for two. So wherever the value available of the banana, it will replace it by two. So it and so if you have n different values for that particular variable, then those will be replaced by those n numbers correspondingly. So that's one of the way you can do the encoding. The second way of encoding is one-hot encoding. So in case of one-hot encoding, what is done is, for a particular variable, whatever number of possible different values you have, those many number of columns are added to your data. So let's say if I consider the sex column in our case, then we have two genders available, male and the female. So what it will do is, it will try to add two columns in our data set. And if the gender is male, it will keep one in the first column. If the gender is female, it will keep one in the second column. So that is one hot encoding. Let's say if you have four different cities, like let's say, and if you want to encode them by using one hot encoding, then what it will do is, let's say if you consider the example of fruit only, like we have four fruits. So what it will do, it will add four columns to your data set. And one column is reserved for the apple, another is for the banana, another is for the mango, and another is for the grapes. So if the apple comes, it will keep one over there, rest will be zero. If the banana comes, it will keep one in that column, rest it will keep zero. So what in turn it is doing, one hot encoding, it is adding those many number of columns to your data set, those many combinations or the different possible values that you have for that particular column. Fine. So it may drastically increase the number of columns in your data set or in your whole data. So you should use it wisely. There is a small variation of this one hot encoding in which you can have one less column. Like let us say if you consider the case of a gender, then by default it will add two columns. If it is male, it will keep one in the male column, zero for the gender, so female. Similarly, if it is female, then will keep zero for the male and one for the female. But instead of that, you can have one less column. It means only one column can indicate, either by zero and one. Zero means male, one means female. So that kind of small optimization you can do by, let's say, instead of having n different columns added, you can have n minus one. So that can be done, or even it can be in terms of a binary encoding. So where each of the possible value is given some binary number. Fine. So compared to your one-hot encoding, the binary encoding will obviously take less number of columns. Let's say if you have 100 different values for a categorical variable, then in case of one-hot encoding, there will be 100 columns added. One you reduce, let's say. So there will be 99 columns. Whereas in case of binary encoding, you can consider like 2 raised to something. So let's say if we do, then 2 raised to 7 or 8 will maximum will suffice that particular possible combination, and those many number of columns will be added. So that can be either binary encoding. In our example of Titanic dataset, we will try to convert our gender column as well as the embark column to the numbers. So let us see what we can do. So for that, you can call the get dummies method of your panda. Get dummies, we want to update the sex column, and drop first. So drop first is equal to true, means instead of creating two different columns for the gender column, one for male and female, we know that only one column is sufficient, zero and one. Similarly, for the embark, you do train embark drop first is equal to 2. So it means we will have, let's say if there are 4 different values possible, then there will be 3 columns added. So let us run this part. Then we have created 2 different separate array kind of things. One will hold the value of the gender 10 for male female and embark for the, you can say, the city or the port from where the passenger bought it. So what you can do is, you, now later on you have to concatenate. So whenever you do pd.concat, the train is the original data set. There are 12 columns. Now we have added columns for the sex and we have added column for the embark. So whenever you run this command, the columns are added which are new generated. Then again let us run the info method. Then you can see now, initially we were having 12 columns, 0 to 11. Now we have added one more column, that is, let's say male, and it has got 891 values now, because there was no missing. Similarly, this Q and S are the columns which are added for the embark field, where you can say that there are 3 possible ports there, so you can encode in between 2 columns. So Q and S are the columns. So those we have added in our original data set. So now our total number of columns becomes 14. Now you can easily drop these 2 columns, sex and the embark, because for that we have added the numerical values in terms of male, Q and S, right? So that we have already done. So those can be removed. So that is how you can convert your categorical variable to numerical. Either you do with the label encoding, one-hot encoding. So we have done one kind of one-hot encoding. Each column, we have added number of columns depending on the possible values that a particular variable has. And the next thing that we'll not do it at this time, but that is also involved in your data pre-processing, is the scaling or normalization of the data. So scaling is a mechanism by which we try to feed the values in particular range. Now, first of all, we should have a question that why we should normalize or scale the data. So if we do not scale the data, then we say in our data set also, if you see, there is one column for the fare, maybe the ticket value, maybe in dollars or something. There is one column for the age. So maybe the one column is in hundreds, the other column is in between 0 to 100. So whenever you try to train any of your model, then it may happen that the column or the variable which is having larger value will, you can say, contribute more into the solution compared to the columns which are having smaller values. So to avoid that situation, you may need to scale down all your variables in particular range, or maybe in between 0 to 1. So for that you need to perform a scaling. The other thing that the benefit of scaling, you can say, is that whenever you have very large values in your variable, then we know that whenever any mathematical operation is to be performed, then it will take long time to perform it on a larger value compared to the smaller value in terms of computation as well. So that is why before you do any kind of analysis or any kind of further training of the model, you should scale down. And I think in your earlier examples also, you might have performed the scaling of the variables. But as such, in our this session, we are going to apply actually the scaling. But at least we should know that what is scaling or normalization, and what is the importance, why it is required. Okay. So the next thing now, so till now we have discussed about the getting brief information of data set. Second, the getting the preliminary pre-processing of your data set. Now let us move ahead towards the various univariate and bivariate or multivariate analysis methods. So the first method or the first category of the analysis that we'll do is about univariate, means we will do it for single variable at a time, and we will use the non-graphical analysis method. So now here onwards, there are four or five slides or whatever the hands-on we will see. We should try to understand that what should be used at which time. So let us say, if I say I want to do univariate analysis and which is non-graphical, then the univariate variable can be either categorical or quantitative, because that we know. So if your variable is categorical variable, then generally the tabulation of frequencies is done. Means you have to, as a non-variate analysis, non-graphical analysis of univariate, you prepare the table which is showing the frequency of occurrences of each possible value, because it's a categorical value. Fine, it is not actually the numerical or the quantitative value. It can be ordinal or you can say without, there is no impact of the order. Fine, so nominal. So in that case, the only non-graphical analysis you can do is just tabulation of the frequency, like this value is coming this much of time, this is coming this much of time. But if it is a quantitative data, then you can either check the central tendency of that particular variable by analyzing its mean, median, or the mode. You can get the information about the spread. It means in which range the value resides. And that is what we saw in terms of the earlier also. That's IQR, that's a interquartile range, which will give you that the values are spread in which range, and beyond the range you have to omit. So I think you might be knowing the how to find out the IQ range and all. It is I think if you know the median calculation, then based on that the median is your Q2, then the data between your first to the median, again you find a median, that will be your, let's say, Q1, and similarly right side of it will be Q3. So what you can do is this kind of analysis will help you to identify the outliers. So if any value is less than Q1 minus 1.5 IQR, so whatever is the quartile range, you multiply it by 1.5, and if it is falling beyond that much by the Q1, then can be considered as the outlier. Similarly for the Q3 plus something. And even you can use the variance or the standard deviation kind of analysis also for the univariate non-graphical. So whenever it's a non-graphical, we will not plot any graph, but we will try to work in terms of the numbers. Similarly, whenever we want to go for the graphical and the univariate, then you have several options available in terms of the charts and the plots. So for categorical variable, the useful charts are the pie chart, which can show the proportion of each category in your data, or even you can represent those proportion in terms of a bar graph. But if your variable is quantitative, then you can plot the histogram or the box plot. This is a simple histogram which can show that how the values are taken by your variable X, right? So now let us see this same thing, how we can use with our data set. And so let us see that first we will try to do the non-graphical analysis of your categorical variables. So first thing what you can do is you can get the unique values. So if you run it, then for P class, there are three unique values, first, second, or third. Similarly, for embark, so now what we are doing only for the categorical variable, fine. So for embark field, the unique values are S, C, Q, and NAN. Maybe there are some null values available. So S, C, and Q are the unique values for your embarked column. Similarly, for the sex column, see, we are not working with the columns which we have generated by the one hot encoding. Still we are going with our original columns, which are in terms of, let's say, categorical variable. We are not working in terms of numbers, right? So if you run this, then you know that the sex column has two different values. So the unique is a function which can help you to just get the brief that how many unique values are there and which are those. Okay. Then for tabulation purpose, you can use a cross tab. And what you can say is you want to just list out the count in terms of, let us say, gender wise. Fine. So if you do this kind of cross tab, it will just give you out of your data set the categorical variable. For a categorical variable, let's say the sex, then what is the frequency? So what it says is, like, there are total 314 female passengers and there are 577 male passengers. So this is, we are just getting the some information about the categorical variable, non-graphical. Like this many were the male, this many were the female. Similarly, if we see for the passenger class, then there are 216 people who traveled in the first class. Similarly, 184 and 491 were the passengers who traveled in the second and the third class. So for categorical variable, for non-graphical analysis, the simplest way is to just tabulate the frequencies. Like how many times that particular variable is taking which value. And same thing it can be for the embark in our case. Like we know that maximum people, you can say, boarded from the, let's say, port has. Now, if we want to do the univariate analysis for the categorical variable, still we are on the categorical variable. Univariate non-graphical is done in terms of tabulation. For graphical, as I said, you can plot the pie chart. So graphically, you can also understand that how the, what is the proportion. So you can do the train dot group by the sex column, and you are plotting the pie chart. So here also graphically we can see that 64 or 65% of the passengers were male and around 35% were female. Similarly, for the passenger class, you can do the graphical part in terms of the percentages, the first class, second class, third class. Similarly, you can also use a bar plot to analyze graphically, just to visualize. So see, in case of ADA, you may have to come across several different kind of graphs. The same kind of message you are getting from numbers, same you are getting from the graph. Fine. So you have to use all such things in combination. And it is not like in terms of some rules. Fine. Your whole analysis process is not driven by any hard-coded rules that you do this. But as and when you go, as and when you understand your data set, you have to go by your own way. And so this is the bar graph kind of way of plotting your, you can say, the genders. And so similarly, it can be for different, so no need to show this. Now, let us continue with the non-graphical analysis for a univariate member, but if the member is numeric. Hello?
Sir, please try to conclude the session within 5 minutes so we can have a question-answer session for a few minutes.
Yes, it will take 10 minutes, not 5, because I have to skip something. I will go quickly. But still, I will take 10 minutes. Then we will have a question answer. Huh.
Okay.
So for non-graphical univariate analysis, for the numeric variable, whatever we have seen was for the categorical variable. Now, univariate analysis for numeric variable. So it can be done either in terms of you print a table, the summary steps, summary states. Means you summarize your values, like what is the skewness, what are the different distinct values, the mean, standard deviation, the IQR range, minimum value, maximum value. So you can plot in terms of such summary table. Or else you can calculate the quartile range. As I said, that the maximum values of that particular variable falls in which range, like as we have done for the age variable, box plot, if you can recall. So that IQR you can represent in terms of a number also. So so let's say if Q1 is this, if you are doing the age IQR, then you can say the IQR range for the age is 15. Fine. So you can know what is the value of Q1, and you do -1.515. If comes outside, you keep it as outlier, and similarly for the Q3. So you can do it by numbers also. You can find out the standard deviation, like how the values of a variable are differing from each other. You can find out the variance of, you can say, particular variable also. Then for graphical univariate analysis, one of the thing that we do several times is we plot the histogram. So histogram will tell us the values are how distributed. So this is the histogram for the age variable, fine. And from where we can see that the maximum of the people who traveled in this Titanic were in the range of, let's say, 20 to 40. This is the frequency. Fine. So more younger people traveled in this their journey in the Titanic. Fine. So histograms you can plot for the single variable, or even you can have the histogram all in one, so that you can just do the train.hist and we'll do the histogram for all your variables. Okay, so this is the histogram for your age, then passenger ID, survived. Some of the histograms may not make sense, like the survived. Generally, for the variable which is you can say quantitative, this may make a sense, because age is a you can say quantitative variable. Okay. Then even you can draw this kind of the box plot as we have done. So this is your IQ range. The maximum values of the age falls between, you can see, the 20 to 40, and this is your IQ minus 1.5. Sorry, Q1 minus 1.5 IQ and Q1 plus 1.5 IQ. So if your median value is, or if you just, you can see, you observe this, that the right part of this box is more having more length than the left. So in that sense, you can say that the distribution of the age variable is skewed somewhere in terms of, let's say, left side, because you have less values this year mean. So the box size is smaller over here. So what kind of skewness you have, that can also be observed from your box plot. And so you can get the skewness from the describe also, and graphically also you can get that there is some skewness in your data. So this is one more way that you can do some graphical analysis of your univariate graphical analysis. And so for graphical analysis of univariate, you do either the you can say the box plot, or you do the histogram. Those are the some most commonly used options. Now if we go for the you can say the bivariate analysis, fine. So in bivariate analysis, we have to take two variables at a time. Now whenever we take two variables at a time, then there are, you can say, three main possible combinations. Either both the variables are continuous, means both are having continuous value, both are numeric variables, then you can use the concepts like covariance and the correlation to identify the relationship between those two variables, whether both are proportional, inversely proportional, what is the correlation, what is the covariance, the Pearson correlation coefficient, the simplest way you can identify. But it can be applied. So whenever it's a bivariate and non-graphical, let us say, then there are three possible combinations. Both are continuous, both are categorical. Means, let's say if we want to analyze the survived and the passenger class in our case, so both are categorical variable. So in that case, what you can do is, for non-graphical analysis, you can use some cross tabulation mechanism. Even you can perform the chi-square test to understand your, to, or you can say to estimate or to get the detail about the hypothesis, like how, what is the association between two categorical variables, like is there any association between the passenger class and the survived or not, because both are categorical, fine, though are not numerical or the continuous variables, so you cannot apply some covariance correlation, but in that case you can use the cross tabulation or chi-square test. Similarly, the third combination is one of the variable is categorical and another variable is numerical. So numerical variable may have very frequent, or maybe you can have the very huge set of values out of which it will get the value. The categorical variable may get the values from some fixed set. So in that case, if you want to find out the relationship between these two variables, you can do some analysis either in terms of a t-test or in terms of an ANOVA. The t-test is generally useful whenever you can say that the you want to analyze the relationship between a numerical variable, continuous variable, and the categorical variable having maximum two categories. Right? So in that case, you can perform a t-test to identify that whether these two are having any relationship or not. Let us say in our example, the age is a, you can say, a continuous numeric variable, whereas the survived or not is a categorical variable, where there are only two possible values, 1 and 0. For age, you have several possible values. So is there any relationship between the survived and age? So how will you know that? Because one is categorical, one is a numeric variable. So in that case, you have to use a t-test kind of hypothesis. Like you can have your null hypothesis, like there is no effect of age on your survival. And your alternate hypothesis can be the age affects the survivability chance. So which one is true? So all those things can be done by using t-test. Similarly, for your categorical variable, if it is taking more than two categories, maybe let's say your the embark column, or maybe another column which is having more values in terms of categorical, then in that case, you have to use the ANOVA method, that is analysis of variance. So where there also you have to make some assumption in terms of your null hypothesis, and you have to either reject or you have to identify the type errors based on the probability value that you have taken. So for non-graphical analysis of bivariate, either you do covariance correlation numerically, you do cross-tabulation, or you do some hypothesis testing like chi-square, t-test, or ANOVA. Similarly, for bivariate analysis, I have to skip because we are out of time, so we cannot go. But if you want to do the bivariate analysis using some graphical techniques, then there are several plots available. Either you can go with the scatter plot, a box plot, bar graphs, or the pair plots. The scatter plot will easily give you the indication that how two variables are correlated. So let us see the example of that scatter plot, so you can easily understand. I have to skip so much part because I have already designed all those chi-square test and t-test all. Okay. Yeah, so for non-graphical, okay, t-test, we cannot go at this point of time. Okay, so for non-graphical, numeric to numeric means both are numeric variables. You can find out a covariance. If you find out the covariance of, let's say, we have taken some dummy values. Now you can see that both are x and y, both are numeric. And you can observe that as the x value increases, the y value is also increasing. You can see 1.2, 2.56, 2.12. There is some relation. So those can be identified by using some covariance and correlation. The covariance will have not fixed range. It can be some from minus 2 plus any value. So it will say that they are positively, or they are directly proportional or inversely proportional. But how much is the relation, they will not tell you. For that, you need to find out the correlation coefficient. So let us see in this case. You can see that there is a covariance of 0.9. it means positive covariance, means both are having, both are proportional. As x increases, y is also increasing. So you further you can do is, you can do the plot the Pearson correlation value, and which will give you the actual, that how much they are attached in terms of correlation. So it is the value between 0 and 1, and you can see that as the value of correlation is near to 1, they are quite proportional to each other. And if it is 0, there is no correlation, and if it is less than, then they are inversely proportional. I think that slide I have in the PPT. So let me show that. Okay. Yeah. So if your correlation value, let's say this, if the values of x and y, if x is increasing, y is decreasing, right? Then you can say that if you are getting correlation value of minus 0.5, then there is a negative correlation. That's an inverse kind of relationship, but not high level. If you are getting something like 0.9, then you can observe that the x and y values are falling somewhere on the same line. Means they have very high negative, you can say the relation, inverse relation. And if it can be a perfect, means a straight line can be used to join all your values, then you can say they are very high negatively correlated. Then same thing can be there for the positive part also. And this is the example where you can say that you cannot identify any correlation. X is increasing, y is also increasing sometimes, maybe decreasing sometimes. So you cannot find any kind of correlation. So for any two variables which are of type numeric, the best way to understand them is by using the covariance and the correlation. And that kind of correlation will help you that whether you should keep that column in your data set or not. Let's say if I have one column which is having perfect positive relationship between these two columns, what does it mean? That if I drop one of the column, it won't make any difference in my further processing, because both are contributing same in my data set. And so this kind of intuition or this kind of internal things you have to obtain by performing the hypothesis testing or by doing this kind of things, so that you can do the reduction of your columns, and then you can proceed. Fine. So there are so many things left, but anyway, I will share this to you so you can go through. As we are running out of the time, let me conclude at this point of time. So if you have any questions or anything, you can ask.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a knowledge-rich session. Dear participants, if you are having any question, then you may ask me.
How to know some categorical variable contents numerical without looking at it? Programmatically, is it possible?
Hello?
Yeah, hello?
Yes, bolo, huh? Yes.
How to know a categorical variable contents numerical? Suppose it's a data set. Without looking at the data set, can we programmatically know this?
Yes, you can find out the information, and you can have the distinct and all these things, like as we have seen, that how many distinct values are held by the particular variable. That way you can do it, no? Because I think I shown you that for the passenger class.
I mean, can we apply some function parameters and programmatically?
Yeah, I think if you can recall, then then what we did is for that one. Yeah, you can just call unique on your column so that it will give you the unique values. Hello?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So you can call a function like unique on the particular column, and it will just give you the list of unique values and from where you can know that whether the values are having not numeric or not.
Yeah, I was just trying to find out, I mean, whether there is the possibility to fix it in place, you know, rather than everything and looking at yourself and deciding. So type of.
Yeah, but actually, whenever you do it in terms of, let's say, the exploratory analysis, then it is better that you just go through, because that will very greatly help you later. Like you can remove some unnecessary quietly correlated columns and all such things. Fine. So
I think that's true.
You should.
Achha, which one would you advise? Let's say you are talking about categorical to numeric. Suppose I'm having an input variable which is actually name of person. So I don't have fixed number, right? So how do you categorically, this is one categorical variable. Say, how to convert it? My question is, suppose somebody gives one person, will decide the gender. Hope you understand, right? So in this case, I have to assign some value to this. Because I will not go with NLP or something to find out how does it sound, so that it can decide whether it is male or female, rather than assigning. I mean, I don't know exactly, but I want to assign some numeric.
If you consider the gender kind of variable or such kind of variables, then for textual data, there are a set of methods available where you need to consider the frequency of your letters and all such things. Those I think we have not covered, but those can be used to get some information about your textual data, and then you can do the further processing about finding the your relationship between those two columns.
So it doesn't need to be converted to numeric, exactly the name of the person.
Yeah,
right?
Because the name, if we consider a name as a field, then how will you do it? Because, and again, it depends on your data set. But converting those into, because you may have all different names, because let's say if we consider the smaller data set like this, there are 890 columns and all are unique, right? So how will you can do that binary encoding kind of thing where you assign one value, but it won't make much.
I'm in this world, there are a lot of names, and we cannot just assign numeric value to each name just to conditionally check whether the gender female or male. So when new data comes, new name comes, I can directly greet somebody as Mr. or Mrs., let's say.
But for that, what you can do is, like, you can let's say you have the whole bunch of data, then you can have the frequency values for each of the names, and then you can correlate those kind of derived features with the other columns. Like, let's say this name is coming more frequently, then the way kind of depending on some other parameters, you can easily identify that what the person name is. So that kind of extra operations you have to do.
Yeah, thanks. We will look at it.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. So we need to end our session here. Thank you very much, sir, once again.
Okay, so I will send this PPT and the data set and the Python book to the WhatsApp of the madam.
Yes, sir. Okay, fine.
So
thank
then
you
can share.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Dear participants, thank you very much for participation. We will begin our third session at 2:30 p.m. today after half an hour break. Thank you.